Okay, now we'll go live to the participants. I am just starting. Over half a minute broadcast, I mean introduction, and then we'll start. உங்க வீடியோ கொஞ்சம் ஆஃப் பண்ணிக்கோங்க. Happy afternoon, students. We are back again with our first episode in the series 21. The speaker for today is Mr. P.K. Raghunathan. I have known Mr. Raghu for almost 20 years now. He is a corporate trainer. He's got industry experience of banking, insurance, aviation. And apart from that, he conducts a lot of training programs for the corporates and college students. He has done a lot of programs for our Prayas team also, and he's been one of the sought after speakers. So last week we had launched a series of 21 talks by Mr. Raghu over a period of next 10 to 11 weeks. So in that series, today we have our first episode called Time and What I Do With It. So we currently have about 30 odd participants live on the Zoom webinar, and a few of them are again on YouTube. So I mean they must be aware that the channel goes live on YouTube also. So some of them have not registered and they are live on YouTube. So I would urge all those who are on YouTube in future to come join us in the live webinar so that you can ask your questions. So earlier we used to chat, I mean you used to send your questions through the chat and I used to read them to the presenter. We are trying to do something new today. This is a webinar where you will be able to participate and ask questions. So on your mobile screens or on your tabs or the systems what you're operating, you may have a Q&A session, I mean a button, ask for asking questions, so that post your questions as the program proceeds. And there is a separate chat box in case you just want to communicate or inform us something. So be clear, any questions you have, let it come through the Q&A panel. And if you want to chat or convey something general, you put it on the chat box. So once your question is being read, if it is required, we'll pause the presentation and answer your question, or you will be given permission to ask the question yourself at the end of the presentation. Today's session is in terms of time and what do I do with it. May go up to about 50 minutes to 60 minutes, and then we will have a 10 to 15 minutes Q&A session based on the number of questions we receive. So usually we try and finish it in 40, 45 minutes. This may get extended up to 60 to 75 minutes. So reserve your questions, throw them on the Q&A section. I already see someone has posted their first question. So 37 participants as we start. I'll hand you over to Mr. Raghu. Thank you. And just give me a minute. Anak, can you come on video, please? Beautiful. So I will switch to the background. The webinar is live. There are 37 participants and you can go live.
I have one request. In case when I'm presenting, there are some questions coming in and you think it's important, could you just...
Anna, your voice is very low.
in case the questions come and you read it,
okay,
you want to ask, can you stop and ask, because I may not be able to see the questions while I'm
I'll do that. I'll take care of that. So you're live now. You can go live. Yeah.
Lovely. Vanakkam. It's great to be back with you. Few thoughts before we go on to the presentation as such. One, I told you that please bring in a paper and a pen to write down your thoughts. Also, while you're sitting here and listening to me on this topic, you may have a question or a two. Write it down right away. We know a lot about it. I'm going to share something about it. See if it answers your questions. At the end of it, request you to share your feedback on this session and also about any other topics that you think are important to be covered during this. Adeshji and his team will look into it and come back to me on that. If it is appropriate, we will definitely carry forward and do it. Please also share it with your friends. Please also tell your friends. Also, please remember that this learning is for yourself. However, please share it, the learnings, with your friends, with your family. If something is very important, they will also benefit out of it based on your learning and experience. Go back and implement it. Once this session is over, some learnings you would remember. Please go back and implement it. There may be some questions, some doubts that you may have. Depending on the time, I think we will allocate some time to also take care of any questions that may come from the previous session. Maybe a few minutes we will allocate that if there are any questions. Please also remember not to compare yourself with anybody else. Each individual is different. Each individual's objectives, goals, dreams, aspirations, backgrounds are all different. We all are different. So don't compare. Yes, if there is any learning that you want to get from somebody else, please take those learnings and adapt it to your situation. Don't copy it exactly because it will not apply it. Each one views it differently. So learn from it, adapt it, use it. Last time, I told you that you are a diamond. And I said I will tell you what it means next session. So I just want to share with you a brief on what did I mean by saying that you are a diamond. See, all of us are born diamonds. And just like a diamond, when you just leave it there, over a point of time, a lot of dust gets accumulated on top of it. A lot of muck gets around it. And then we wonder that, what is this? I mean, people say that there was once upon a time a diamond, but this just looks like a stone. Just like that, maybe after a long time, after many years, just like that, maybe one rain comes in or one wind comes in, and at that moment, something opens up and there is a sparkle that comes out of it, and people look into it, peep into it and wonder, and then open it up and realize that, oh, this is not an ordinary stone or a junk, it's a diamond. Likewise, you are a diamond, you're born diamond, but over a point of time, over years, family, friends, relatives, associates, neighbors have all been throwing muck at you and you've been accumulating that muck. And then one day you realize that, why is that nobody is treating me very well? And one morning you wake up and realize something sparkles come. You read a book or you read an article, you watch a program, you attend a training program, something that sparkle, small hole comes out of it. And then you wonder, and people wonder, oh, you are a diamond. You wonder, you are a diamond. In case of a diamond, it's an inanimate object. We just use that to show that how priceless you are. You are not an inanimate object. You are an animate object. We are all human beings. One opening, I think we should be able to look at life differently and realize that I was a diamond. I am a diamond. I will be a diamond. So please keep that perspective that you are a diamond. People will throw muck at you. People will throw junk at you through their words, through their thoughts, through their actions. But don't take that. If you take it, then wonder why one day, why things are not happening to you in your life, why things are not progressing the day you want. That's because you always thought that you are a muck, you are a junk. Throw that away out of you and realize that you are a priceless gem. And that's a diamond. So let's move on to our topic, time and what do I do with it. So let me take the presentation and share it. At any point of time, you are not able to hear me clearly, please mention it. Okay, time and what do I do with it? What is the focus of our discussion for the next 45, 50 minutes? I have ensured that there is maximum learning in minimum time. So please pay attention to what I am saying. And end of it, if you have any questions, please feel free to raise it. And then we will discuss it. I mean, some of it, time permitting, we will address it. Otherwise, if it's all possible, we'll address all of it. Okay, now time and what do I do with it? Now, what are we going to cover in our discussion today? We're going to look at a little bit about self-evaluation. We're also going to look at time management approaches and time structuring approaches. Many of you may be familiar with that. If you're familiar with that, it's a recapitulation of what you already know. If you don't know about it, it's going to be a new learning for you. Now, each one of us have 24 hours a day. Each one of us have 168 hours a week, and it goes on. What I want you to do from now on is that, at least for some time to come, until you become very familiar with it, start writing down what you do with that 24 hours. How do I spend my time? What do I do with my time? Can you write it down? Can you keep a logbook like a daily calendar right from the morning you get up, 5:30, 6? 4:30, some people may get up. Whatever time you get up till whatever time you sleep. What do you do with your day? Please understand that this is not to make you feel bad. Please understand that entire objective of this exercise, of this presentation is what are you doing with your day and what you want to do with your day. For example, if the day starts at 6 o'clock and the day ends at about 10:30, 11 o'clock, and you realize that I've been sleeping seven hours, and in the middle also you find that you've been sleeping for about 2 hours, you realize that I'm sleeping for 9.5 hours. So what do I do with that? Do I sleep less? Do I sleep same? That's a decision to be taken. Nobody's going to tell you that you should not sleep for 9 hours. You should not sleep for 6 hours, or you should sleep for 8 hours. No, there is no right or wrong. Start documenting that. Okay, the question might be that, do I document every minute? It depends. If you think that you have a 15 minute sort of activity that you do, you want to document it as every 15 minutes, do that. You want to do it every 30 minutes, do that. As long as you are able to go back and read what you have written in terms of trying to determine where all are you spending your time in a day. And you'll find that there is a pattern that emerges. the time that you spend to sleep, the time you spend to read, the time you spend to watch television or spend time with your friends, time you spend with your personal things in terms of having a bath or eating, or time you spend with your family. So each one you will get to know, and there is a pattern that will emerge indicating what am I doing with my time in terms of where does my time go. So many of them say that, oh, I don't know what happens to my time. Now, this is a classic way to find out where does your time, and you categorize it yourself afterwards. I don't want to tell you how to categorize. We will talk about categorization later, but you do this and you can do it independent of the other two concepts. I'm going to talk about it. You can categorize it your own way, like time spent with family, time spent in eating, time spent in reading, time spent in watching television, time spent talking to friends, time spent doing nothing, time spent in sleeping. Why should I do all this stuff? Simple reason, you should know about yourself better. Only then the world will know you. If I don't know what I do with my time, how will the world know how to use my time? Because if I don't value my time, the world is not going to value my time or myself. So this is one thing that you do about it. Now we'll talk about a couple of concepts. One of them is something which is an internationally acclaimed concept, which is called a time management quadrant. You can find this in a book called Seven Habits of Highly Effective People, written by Stephen R. Covey. It's been an international bestseller for several years. The gentleman is no more. However, he's left behind a strong legacy of concepts that we all are using it even today. How does he categorize time? He categorizes time as, is it urgent? Is it not urgent? And is it important? Is it not important? So how do you determine urgency? Urgency is where you have to do it right away, immediately, at this point of time. You can't delay it any further. Urgency, not urgent. Yes, I would like to do it, but I don't have to do it right away. Is it important or is it not important? That's the second way of categorizing it. Important. The importance is from my perspective. It is not from the perspective of other people. It is the perspective of myself. Importance is for me, not for others. So look at it. Is it important from my perspective? So that's how the categorization is made. So this quadrant now gets into four. It is important and urgent, important and not urgent, not important and urgent, and not important and not urgent. Now let's try to understand. Just give me a moment. Something is flickering. I'm just trying to understand, what do I do with that? Adeshi, a lot of things flicker coming. Do I ignore it? Okay, I'll move on. Now let's look at in terms of back to our presentation. Just give me a moment. Yeah, we looked at urgent, not urgent, important and not important. That's how the categorization is made. Now let's try to understand the first quadrant. It's important and urgent, which means that I have to do it right away because it's urgent. And it is important for me, so I have to do that. What would be an example like that? See, typically you will find that, take a common example that is given for that, which is important and urgent, is that there is an urgency. Somebody falls down, hurts himself. So is it important for me to attend? Yes. It could be a family member. It could be a neighbor. I'm there. I'm only person there. So it is important for me to attend it. Is it urgent? Of course, the person has fallen down, requires immediate attention to it. So that's a normal standard example given into explain urgency and importance. Let's take a typical example that we go through, which is urgent and important in our daily lives. Like, for example, my office is at 9:30 and I have to, it takes me about, let's say, 45 minutes to reach there. So I know that I have to leave the latest by about 8:40, 8:45 latest to reach there. So what do I do? If I can plan myself and leave at about 8:30, 8:40, I'll be able to reach the destination very well. But what do? I get up late. So I realize that I am rushing in. I have to go have a quick bath. I have to get ready. And I realize that it's 8:47. I rush through, reach my place at 9:29 after all that tamasha. Then I wonder, what has happened? Why is this I'm going through? The reason is because I made a normal activity into an urgent activity. Why did I do that? You will get to know as we discuss it. But a normal activity I made into an urgent activity. Let's take another example. We are sitting and discussing at home in the night. At about 9 o'clock, dinner is all done. Now, suddenly, out of the blue, some relatives walk in and say, I'm hungry. I mean, they just walk in and say, we forgot to communicate with you. And I've come here. I've come from station. And we have not eaten anything. So what do we do? Is it important to take care of them? Yes, because they are relatives. They are known to us. Is it urgent? We can't tell them, no. It will take about 2-3 hours for us to cook. So I'll do it leisurely. No, it's extremely urgent and important to do that. So that is what is quadrant number one. So it is important as well as urgent. So typically our crisis, challenging issues, or timeline driven projects, end of it, we rush through. So let's through. Hello? Hello? Am I audible?
Yes. Please go ahead now.
Okay. So let's take the next. We looked at quadrant one. Now let's look at quadrant three. I'll come to quadrant two later. What is quadrant three? It is urgent. Okay. It is urgent. Somebody knocks at the door. Is it urgent for it to be opened? Yes, it has to be opened. I'm sitting in the office or sitting in the residence. The landline is ringing. Should it be picked? Yes, it should be picked. But there are five people in the house. What do? I rush and pick up that phone call. I rush and pick up, open the door. So what happens is that it is urgent to pick it up or answer the doorbell because it is ringing or somebody is ringing there. But is it important for me? May not be. In many cases, it may not be. That's why it is a quadrant three activity. We all get into these activities of doing things which is not important, but appears very urgent. So because it is urgent, we think it is important for us to be involved in it. See, please categorize that. What is urgent? Is it important or not important? If it is important, you should do it. If it is not important, should you do it? Can you ask somebody else to do that? So typically at home, you walk around there and say, okay, can I help you, mama? Can I do this work for you? Can you do? She not ask for your help. Yeah, if you have time, you can do it. But suddenly you realize that I've spent my time and somebody's ringing the doorbell. I answer that. Then I realize that all of it I've been doing as if it's urgent, but it's not important for me. So think through on that. What is urgent need not be important. Quadrant four. A very, very commonly spent time activity for many of us is neither important nor urgent, which means that it doesn't have to be done now. It need not be done by me at all. What is that? Chit-chatting with people, walking on the road and talking to people because I want to spend my time. Social media, which is something commonly happening. We spend a lot of time in social media, watching videos, watching chatting with friends. Is it urgent? No. Is it important for me? No. So that's another quadrant where I spend lot of my time. Now, while we're discussing this, think through to yourself how much time in a day I spend in each quadrant. First one is, I told you, where all do you spend your time? Now, in this quadrant 1, quadrant 2, quadrant 3, quadrant 4, how do I spend my time? Now, let's come to the quadrant 2 part of it, which is the most important one. Quadrant 2 activities are important but not urgent. Classic activities in terms of quadrant 2 that we have to do, which probably many times we don't do. As college students, I must be sitting and reading my books. I must try to equip myself in terms of how do I pass all my subjects very well, get good marks. How do I spend time with my family? How do I spend time with friends in a qualitative manner to build relationships with them? How do I read books which are important for me to pursue into the corporate world? Now, these are opportunities. How do I plan for the future? Goal setting is another example where comes under the quadrant 2. So where am I spending my time? So this is a quadrant 2 activity, which is not urgent. You don't have to do it now at all. You can, there is 1 month available for my exam. So I have a lot of time. So if I allocate the time and do it now, it's not urgent, but it's important. So I'm able to study well, spread my time across and prepare. Otherwise, what do I do? 2 days before the exam, typically quadrant 2 activity becomes a quadrant 1 activity because I have not spent my time in quadrant 2. If you spend maximum time in quadrant 2, Stephen Covey says, you will spend minimum time in quadrant 1. Because what is not urgent, if you spend in a relaxed manner, it will not become urgent for you to spend all your time. So look at it in terms of how to categorize this. So Q1, Q2, Q3, and Q4. So where am I spending my time? Am I spending my most of my time in Q1 or Q2 or Q3 or Q4? Typically, it is said, you can reflect on it later on. It is typically said that bulk of your time must be spent on quadrant 2 activities. If you don't spend bulk of your time in quadrant 2, you will realize that you will start spending more on quadrant 1 because what is not urgent earlier becomes urgent now. Okay, so this is in terms of time management quadrant. So spend a moment, either now or later on, when you go back, where am I spending my time? What is the percentage I'm spending my time? Now, again, please look at it. What you're spending time should not be compared with anybody else. Let's say, for example, I spend 30% of my time in Q1, 20% in Q2, maybe 10% in Q3, and 40% in Q4. So I realize 30, 20, 10, and 40. Should I continue to, I want to reduce my Q1, which is 30%. So how do I do that? So how do I increase my 40% Q2 further to 50%? If I spend more time in Q2, I will start having lesser to do it in Q1, which is urgent and important. What is done in a relaxed manner will not become urgent later on. What is not done today in a relaxed manner will become urgent. Classically, why do we have so many family problems? Because people don't spend on Q2, which is not urgent but important, to spend time with the family. Spending time with family, quality time with friends, quality time in terms of self-development. Yeah. So this is in terms of time management quadrant as propounded by Stephen R. Covey in his book, 7 Habits of Highly Effective People. Okay. Now let's look at another concept. We talked about time management. Now we'll look at time structuring. Now, if you look at time structuring as such, there are 6 ways that time is structured. I've put here withdrawal, rituals, pastimes, activities, games, and intimacy. Now, please understand here that this is another concept. They say how we spend our time. There are a lot of concepts available. I'm just sharing two of them. So one is time management, we talked about it. Second one is time structuring, we're discussing now. So let's look at each one of them as to how do we structure our time in a day. Now, first one is withdrawal. Now, what is withdrawal? Withdrawal means that I am spending my time with myself and I'm on my own. For example, if I'm sitting and reading a book, okay, just sitting, probably not even reading a book, I'm just sitting, I'm in my meditative thought, that's withdrawal. I am in a group of people, there are a lot of conversations that are happening there, but I am not participating in that conversation. I'm just sitting there. I am lost thinking about something else. I'm wandering around. Okay, what is this? What is that? So I have withdrawn myself from the group activity that is going on. So that's what it says here. Withdrawal is spending time out of contact or out of relationship. Some people physically withdraw and be on their own. Some people say, okay, I want to step out and I want to be on my own. Or some people are there, but yet they are not involved in it. Other people withdraw on the inside. They are physically present, as we said. Something in the corporate world that many of us see that very often, discussions happen, meetings happen. One or two of them are wondering, are lost totally. They are withdrawn from the discussion. They are physically present, mentally absent. Some of your teachers also may have told you about it. You physically seem to be here, but mentally you are seem to be absent. So that's actually a withdrawal. Now, I'll explain all the six concepts about it. Thereafter, you think through, where do you spend your time? How much time you spend in each aspect of it? So first we talked about withdrawal. Second one is rituals. Rituals, normally we use that in our ceremonies, in our pujas, in our whatever routine that we do. Yeah, I mean, that is what this name is borrowed from. But what it means is that typically you meet a friend. Initially, the moment you meet a friend, what do you do when you meet a friend? You spend a brief moment saying hi. So, hi, how are you? How are things with you? What's happening today? If you notice now, I mean, there was a joke going around saying that people no longer ask where are you from when they pick up the phone or when they meet somebody. They ask, which zone are you from? So that's a joke which is going around here. So all these are rituals. That's a startup of a conversation. That's a routine activity. When you go to a bus stand and you meet somebody, you say hi, you go and ask their 17C Mandirtingla. So that's a typical ritual. You say hi and you ask a simple question, and that's a ritual. Ask yourself, how much time do I spend in that? Now at home, what is the ritual that we do? Some of the rituals that we do is that when we wake up in the morning, hi ma, how are you ma? Can I have a cup of coffee ma? So all these typical rituals, how was the day? Did you sleep well? These are rituals. This is something done. So it's like the starting of any conversation, you spend some time. Sometimes maybe that's the only part of the conversation. You walk in, you tell, when you wake up in the morning, you say hi to everybody. That's a ritual, and you go back to your room. That's all. That's a ritual. You've done the ritual part of it. This is routine. This is routinely done by people. It's a polite way of exchanging conversation. That's the starting of any conversation. Anybody who meets on the road, anybody picks up the phone, they say, hi, how are you doing? How are things with you? That's a ritual. So we looked at withdrawal. We looked at ritual. The third one is pastime. Now, what is a pastime? It's basically, in simple terms, I spend my time probably not doing anything significantly useful. Chatting about it, generally talking. The same bus stand, we go there, we talk about it, we say hi, 17th vandirta abindu. No, it says not come. Okay. Then you start chatting with the other person who just come in there. You don't know that person, and you start saying, after you inquired, and you start talking to that person, that new acquaintance you got, about the weather. Rumba veyila irukku illaya. So that's how the pastimes conversation start. Yeah, it's very warm, it's very hot, it is very cold, it is not very warm. The conversation keeps going on for time. Now, what is the object of it? You want to spend the time. The bus has not come. The other person is free. You're free. You have nothing much to do. The other person has nothing much to do. You want to spend time chit-chatting. It is safe. It is not threatening at all. It is not threatening at all. There is no controversy. At that moment, you don't talk about which movie you like, or which hero you like, or which party you like, or which party you don't like. That is not what is a pastime. It is non-controversial. Generally, where does it happen? It happens at home. It happens when we go and spend time with the relatives in a function. When you go there, you go and chit-chat. You talk about several other things that has happened around. What is that we're doing? We're just spending time. That's a pastime that is done. Now, how much am I doing in that? So typically at home, what happens in terms of pastime? You sit and talk about what is happening about the environment, why is things are like this, why are people spending time watching television? Now, these are non-controversial topics. These are general topics. These are not going to cause any discomfort or a pain to anybody else. These are generic topics so that you spend your time. After a while, you say, okay, fine, let me go back and read my book, or let me go and watch television. Whatever, you start doing that. You spend some time, you do a pastime activity, and you go back and do what you're doing. Or you may do something else thereafter. So we looked at withdrawal. We looked at ritual. We looked at pastimes. Now let's look at activity. That's the fourth one. One moment. Yeah, activities. Now, what are activities? For example, a typical mother, typical lady at home, you'll find that for her, get a come in the morning, cooking food, washing clothes is an activity. For somebody who goes to work, working in the office is an activity. For a student, reading a book, attending a college is an activity. You'll find that bulk of the time is spent in activities. Now, that's something typically also aligns with our goals. Many of our activities are linked to the goals that we are doing. We are in a college because we want to study well, we want to get a good job. So there is a goal that we have. So we spend a lot of time in the activities. Activities could be that we do it with ourselves, or activities could be that we spend time with others also. Like, for example, your mother is cooking. So I like to go there and help my mother in cooking. So I help her cutting, chopping vegetables, or I help her in sharing the kitchen work. That's an activity. I do that. I do cleaning of the house. No, that's an activity. Because I'm spending time with a purpose, with an objective, with a utilitarian perspective. So there is an activity. Adeji?
Yes, now I'm here.
There are somebody raised a hand. I'm just trying to check.
We will take care of that in the end. Okay. I posted a question, so maybe they would have raised.
Oh, okay, fine. I just wanted to check that out. Okay. So that
you continue with the presentation.
Okay. In case I'm not audible or whatever, so please let me know.
No, I'm asking them the question, so it's not a problem.
Okay. What time are we in now? We are at 4:40. Okay. I think we are going quite well. So I think in about 10-12 minutes, I should be able to complete my presentation, and then we can take the questions. Okay, activities. We talked about activities. For a student, an activity is different. For a housewife, an activity is different. for a corporate person activity is different, for a businessman an activity is different. For example, a mother who's taking care of her children, taking care of the child is an activity. Cooking is an activity. Washing vessels is an activity. Somebody in the corporate world spending time in the meetings is an activity. But the same person, when he goes around in the morning telling hi to everybody for about 15, 20 minutes, that is not an activity. What is that? That's a ritual. You will find that in the corporate world, some of them go have a cup of coffee and spend time. So how was yesterday? So what happened yesterday? Did you watch that cricket match? Did you watch that movie? Now that is not a withdrawal. That is not a ritual. That is a pastime. So now you understand that there is time we spend for withdrawal. There is a time we spend for pastime. There is time we spend for ritual. There is also significant amount of time we spend for activity. Now you're sitting and listening to me. That's an activity. I am talking to you. That's an activity. But while you are listening to me, you are lost thinking about something else and wandering around. That's not an activity during those moments. That's a withdrawal. You get it? Initially, if you looked at it, Adeshji, when we started this, we said hi, how are you for a moment. That's a ritual. You start the conversation. So we looked at what is withdrawal, what is ritual, what is a pastime, and what is an activity. Now, fifth one is very interesting one. Game. Now, game is something very interesting. Typically, what happens is that it's a time spent with somebody else where the intent of the conversation probably is one, but the actual conversation happens in a different way. And both of them go back at the end of the conversation with a bad feeling. That's the most important one. You have a conversation. You ask something, but the interpretation is at a different level, probably in many cases. And after the end of the conversation, both of them go back with a bad feeling. Before I proceed further, one of the questions you may have that is game a communication or is it a time structuring? Now, yes, I think that question is very valid, very thoughtful. That yes, it could come under communication also, but there is an amount of time I'm spending on this. So I need to know how much time I am spending on this. Let me take a small example to illustrate what is a game. Now, let's say I wear a new dress. I go to my mother and say, I wear a red dress. Visualize yourself doing that with your friend or with your mother or with your father or with the brother or the sister or with a friend. Now you wear a sort of a red dress or an orange dress and you go and ask your mother or friend or your brother or your sister and anybody, how is the dress? So basically, when you ask how is the dress, your intent is, please tell me the dress is nice. But you're asking how is the dress? So the other person looks at it and says, why are you wearing orange? Now the other person, what should they have said? Dress is very nice. But what did the other person turn around and say? Instead of, the person probably did not like the dress, but does not want to say the dress is bad. So the person doesn't want a dress, doesn't suit you. But the person says, why are you choosing orange? So that external conversation happens in one level with a meaning at a different level, intent at a different level. So this conversation goes on for about few moments. So you say that, no, it's my choice. I like orange very well. The other person says, yeah, but you can choose. There are so many other colors that may be more suitable. But basically the conversation happens at one level superficially with a different meaning altogether. At the end of it, you say, fine, okay, thank you very much. I'm going. I mean, thank you for your inputs and guidance. Bye. What did you go back from that conversation with? A bad feeling. But what did you, what was your intent when you walked in, when you showed that dress? You wanted that dress to be appreciated. Does this type of conversation happen all the time? Probably not. Does it happen sometimes? Yes. Does it happen for everybody? Yes. Do people know that it's happening? Probably not. They don't even realize that these sort of games, time is being spent without them realizing about it. So think about it on this, how much time you spend on this. So now we looked at withdrawal, we looked at ritual, we looked at pastime, we looked at activities, we looked at games. The last one is intimacy. Now what is intimacy? This is an authentic encounter, a genuine encounter, where there is a connectivity with the person emotionally. There is a bonding that is happening. There is a connectivity that happens. There is something that is being liked by each other, appreciated by each other. So there is an honesty, there is genuinity, and there is effectiveness in that. Now, the same family example we talked about, when you get up in the morning, we said that, hi, how are you? And all that, we do that, which is a withdrawal. We spend time together chit-chatting. We say that it's a pastime. We do some work at home, reading or cleaning the house or cooking or taking care of a particular task. All these are activities. Some of the conversations could lead into games. And the last one is intimacy, the most important one. What is intimacy in terms of in our time being spent? The same family, when you're sitting there, it could be when you're sitting and eating. The eating can be a ritual where you just come, sit, say hi, hello, just say one or two words and then go. Or you spend time talking about something which is out of the blue, of no relevance at all, and spend your time, which is a pastime. Or it could be an intimate experience where you talk about each other, each person's emotions. The mother may say something, what happened? You may intently listen to what your mother said or what your father talked about, his experience. Ask questions, ask clarifying questions to understand things better. What have you done? I have connected with that person. I'm not forming opinion about what the mother is saying or what the friend is saying or what the brother or sister are saying or what the friends are saying. I am there intimately connected in my sharing of my experiences or in listening to the other person. Sometimes I may share something private. That's where the vulnerability will come in. And that's where trust is also there. Vulnerability is always there only when there is trust. If the trust is not there, people will not share. People will not open up. It's not sharing secrets. Some people are not comfortable about sharing routine also. So where will they be comfortable sharing secrets? So I want to share something. I want to sit and chat. Whom will I chat with? It's only family and close people that I chat with. That's where the intimacy is formed. So we looked at withdrawal. We looked at rituals, pastimes, activities, games, and intimacy. Just let's run through that again to understand what does all this six mean. Withdrawal, either I withdraw from the situation and spend my time. Common withdrawal experiences are when you are praying or when you are meditating or when you are just in your deep thought, just not doing much about it. Typically, that's a withdrawal. If I'm planning something, sitting alone and planning, that does not come under withdrawal. That comes under activity because I'm planning for something, what to do. withdrawal, we talked about it. Second is ritual. Rituals are extremely important to start a conversation. Rituals are extremely important to maintain relationships. You get down from, if you're staying in an apartment or in a block of houses, you get down, you walk across, you meet 20 people. Make an attempt to have eye contact with them and say just a hello or acknowledge their hello. That's a ritual. But why do you have to do that? Human beings need social connect. It's extremely important. I just can't put my head down and walk. I have to look around. I have to see what is happening to me. I have to see what is happening to the world outside. So connect with them. Just a polite hello. Hi. Hi, uncle. How are you doing? Okay, fine, uncle. How are you doing? That's all. As long as you know them. I'm not saying that you should talk to strangers. So we looked at withdrawal. We looked at ritual. Third one is pastime. It is also an important activity. If you don't spend time generally talking about it and you say, no, I want to focus only on activity, which means that you will not relax at all. Pastime is a relaxation. But if you spend all your time in pastime, then what will the activity you will do? So it's not that you don't spend time, at all. Spend little time, less time, some time. But it is important to spend some time. In fact, in my discoveries as a business, when I go and meet clients, I've realized that after the ritual of 30 seconds or 1 minute, sometimes I have to do a pastime for about 15, 20 minutes. We talk about nothing. Sometimes the connectivity happens because he wants to talk about something irrelevant because he has nobody to talk to. He found me. If I tell him, nice, sir, I have to go urgently somewhere. If I genuinely have some work to do, I can go. But if I think that I've got some time and I can spare, I should spare with that. I do spare that time with the client. Some of the conversations with my clients have been as low as 5 minutes. Some of the time with the clients have been as high as more than an hour. When I found that 40 minutes is nothing that I spoke, I just listened. But if I had not listened to it, I wouldn't have come to the activity discussion. I wouldn't have been able to do that because he's not ready to talk about business until he spoke for about 30, 40 minutes. There are clients, as I said, they walk in. Hi, how are you? Okay, so this is what we want to talk about it. This is what I want you to do. Can you do this? No fasting. Fine. That's his call. So withdrawal, ritual, pastime, activity. Activity is the main work that we are involved in, which is goal-oriented. Fifth one is in terms of games. Games where sometimes we genuinely want to connect with somebody, but our intent and their intent not matching. There is an ulterior intent or there is a superficial intent, a superficial communication on one side with a background intent being there. So it doesn't work out very well and it goes back with a bad feeling. It does happen or many times actually it happens. We are not aware of it. Spend some time reflecting on it. Yes, you can minimize it. Yes, you can minimize it. Yes, you should minimize it. Probably it's not very difficult to eliminate it, but you can minimize it. The last one being intimacy, where we spend our time in connecting with people emotionally. You build strong, long-lasting relationships. With that intimacy is where I know that there are few friends of mine with whom I've connected. They say that, Raghu, you can call me at 3 o'clock in the morning. So I also tell them, you can also call me. Why is the 3 o'clock coming in there is because to say that I've built that relationship with you that I can take the liberty to call you at any time. And that liberty to call at any time can only come when the intimacy is built. Would you want to wake up somebody you are very close to, or would you want to wake up somebody you're not very close to? You always want to disturb somebody or take help from somebody whom you're very close to. So this is how the 6 ways time is being spent. You can do a pie chart to understand where do I spend my time. There is nothing called 0% spend. If it is 0%, it is a concern. Because many of you realize that the low times that you spend are in rituals and in pastimes. It is extremely important. spend time in rituals and pastimes. If you don't spend time in rituals and pastime, you will find it very difficult to do activities with the people. Because something you have to start the conversation with. So take out a chart now, later on draw a chart. Where do you spend your time in these six? So earlier, there are three diagrams you have to come up with. One, I said, where do you spend your time? 24 hours a day, 168 hours a day, generally to know where you're spending. From that particular chart, you can then put it to time management quadrant, quadrant one, quadrant two, quadrant three, quadrant two. Where am I spending? Likewise, you can do a time structuring pie chart. Where am I spending my time? 100% of time, where am I spending my time? Okay, summary. How do I spend my time daily? We talked about 24 hours and 168 hours. Time management quadrant, we talked about it. Important, urgent, important, not urgent. Not important, urgent, not important, not urgent. And time structuring, withdrawals, rituals, pastimes, activities, games, and intimacy. Okay. So my presentation is over. Feel free to ask questions now. Thank you very much for your time.
Now, if you open the question answer session, I think you can stop the screen share. And the Q&A session, you will see four questions. So, can we, one second, I'll just move myself into a... Okay, done. So, four questions. So, first question is Jennifer Paul Raj. Can you see the question now?
I found this kind of problem between the CLG students. They sleep only at 1 o'clock. Their breakfast had become lunch between this irregular skill. How to maintain a time management frequently?
Okay, Anna, can you just click on the answer live if it's appearing on you?
Okay.
Yes, you can answer the question now.
No, the question itself is, I want to know. See, the question asked is, how to maintain our time management frequently? See, first question is that somebody else has a problem. Let's not get into that.
Fine.
It's my problem, our problem. What do I do with it? Let's deal with it. Somebody else's problem, let them deal with it. Because for them, if it's not a problem, then why are you trying to solve somebody else's problem when it's not even there?
Done.
So that is one part of it.
Fine. So...
Second one, how can I increase my quadrant two rather than quadrant four? Because I spend much time in that uselessly. Thank you very much. We are all in that. I knew that is just entertainment, but I spend much time in that only. What can I do to overcome that, sir? Please give me some tips. Okay. First of all, what is your goal? Okay. What is your goal? First of all, we should know what is my goal. If I'm not working towards my goal, I will work towards wasting my time. See, there is a presentation I have to make at 4 o'clock today. That's a short-term goal for me. So I had to prepare for that. Even though this is a subject, I have talked about it, I've learned about it, I prepared for it. How much time do I spend preparing? Can I do it 15 minutes before? Which means that it becomes a quadrant one activity. Should I prepare this 1 month before? No. Do I spend time? Yes. When do I spend time? Day before? Morning? How much time do I spend? Is that a quadrant two? Yes. Am I doing it that? If I do it, it's quadrant two. If I don't do it, it becomes a quadrant one. How do I increase? What is my goal? That's a question you should ask. You cannot reduce a quadrant four just like that. It's not a magical wand, abracadabra, then you say quadrant four, go away. It goes away. No, it doesn't. Okay, people say you don't watch mobile for half an hour. How do I tell you not to watch mobile? How do I tell you not to watch mobile? Unless you have a goal. For example, I'm preparing for this presentation. Will I now focus on watching my mobile? No. Because if I continue to watch my mobile during this, which means that either I'm very confident about what I'm going to speak, or I have absolutely no clue about what I want to speak. So what is my goal? Goes back to it. When you want to increase something, you want to reduce something, start with how you want to increase this. The question is very nice because you asked about how do I increase my quadrant two. A very good question. Ask yourself, what is my goal? Yeah, thank you. What is the biggest waste of time? That is something you have to discover. I don't know what is the biggest waste of time. I have no idea. People watch a movie and say, wow, what a learning I've got from that movie. Somebody says, Delaur Padama. So for one, it was a learning. One man's food, another man's poison, as they say. For one, it was a huge learning. For another one, it was absolutely useless. So I don't know. What do you think? You identify in your schedule. Remember, I talked about spending the 24 hours writing down. From that, find out which is the biggest one you're spending your time on. Now go back and say, how do I transfer that time to something else? I'm spending too much time on my mobile. Okay. If you say, how do I reduce spending my time? It will not work out. Instead, turn around and say, what are the three new topics I will learn in the next 1 week? For example, today we discussed about time management, right? For example, this is just a suggestion I'm giving you. Okay, now I will want to learn a couple of more concepts in time management. So that's an objective you got. You go, you read, you ask people, you talk to friends, you find out. So you've learned it. Or turn it around. I'll give you another challenging task. How do I go and explain this time management and time structuring concept to my family members? You spend 3 hours preparing that. So all your time is got effectively utilized. Yeah?
Wonderful. Next question.
Do you appreciate time spent in games? And can you please once again explain time spent in games with simple terms? Simple terms. How do I make it simple? Okay. Now, please think through in the last 2 days. Take one or two examples in family. Pick one. Mother, brother, father, friend. Typically, a conversation would have ended up with a bad feeling. And you would have found out that there is a pattern in that. I just gave an example of how is this stress. It could be that instead of asking how is this stress, you may ask how is my cooking? Or you may turn around and ask how did I speak? Or how did I do this art? It could be anything. It could be something you may start off, or it could be somebody else starting off also. But end of that conversation, you'll go back. Both of you will go back with a bad feeling. Sometimes you will go back exchanging sharp words, or you may go back banging the door, or you may go back by throwing something because you have to express your emotions. So that's when you realize that that's a game I got. Game is not to be connected to the cricket game or a football game. That's a game we play here. The effort probably is to be intimate, but I have an underlying objective. The other person also may have an underlying objective. It doesn't go out very well. That's in terms of what you go back with a bad feeling. Look at the pattern. I'm sure you should be able to get it across. I have a question. Spending time in withdrawal and activity can make an improvement in self-development. Self-development does not mean only withdrawal and activity. Sometimes self-development could happen even with pastimes, because I have discovered that many of us in business, we don't spend much time in pastimes. Actually, that's been a big learning for all of us in business. We start the conversation and move on to the discussion focus. And then we are not able to gel very well. So that's one part of it. In terms of self-development, again, the self-development in what perspective? As I said, for us in business, the self-development is increasing our pastime. We don't know how to increase our pastime. Rituals we do, pastimes we don't know how to do. So that's a self-development required. So I don't know in terms of, it is not that if you do this, you will develop. No. As I said, where am I spending time in a day in these things? How do I change? Put a graph that you are today, put a graph that you want it to be, and then put a roadmap as to how will you go there. That's all it's self-development in this perspective.
Superb. Okay.
How to find whether time managed by me is in a positive way. I love these type of questions.
Hey, Anna, before you continue, I think we have another 3 minutes.
Jennifer, same. Jennifer Polter asked, I think, is she the one who asked
questions? Two or three.
Okay, I'll quickly respond to this and since I clicked it, I will. Madam has also asked a question.
Yeah.
Okay, how to find whether time managed by me is in a positive way? Exactly. Now, 24 hours, I told you to write a log right there. Was it spent positive or not positive? Put a plus and a minus, you know. Anything that is working towards your goal, working towards interacting with family, spending quality time with family, friends, near and dear, I would think is a positive. Making money is not what is positive. Money is incidental. Please understand, one famous person in my personal life said, money and fame is incidental. You cannot go in search of it. It will have to come. So what is positive is something you have to determine. Okay, if you turn around and say, this is what I want to do, that's what it is. Yeah.
We'll take the last question first and then come back to Madam's question.
At which quadrant can I spend my more time, sir? Okay. Quick answer you want to give? Maximum on quadrant two. That's what Stephen Covey says. Spend your maximum time. If you're spending 30%, 40%, he says, can you go up to 80%?
Beautiful.
But
okay, before you answer this question,
you finished it. Okay.
Before you answer this question, the students who are still alive, live, 33 of them and some 17 on YouTube.
Okay.
You don't believe, when I keep appealing to you to call your friends in, and not many of them join. Even though we had an opportunity to come live on Zoom, I think 44 of you came in and there were about 20 odd people on YouTube. But you know what? Every program we do, irrespective it's for a 40 minute or a 1 hour or a 1.5 hour program, all the programs your principal attends without fail. I am sure that you people are more busier than her, that's why maybe you don't, I mean your friends don't attend, and she's been posting questions to me in the chat right from the beginning. She feels that this is program for everybody. It's not just for the students. Anybody and everybody has to watch this video. So I would urge your students to just post this link of YouTube to your friends. Let them watch it. So before Mr. Raghu answers the question, I think I'd like to read the question, because what a student mind goes through, I think she's asked the very apt question. That's why I said we'll answer this last and we'll end the program with this. See, mind is planning certain things. In spite of having decided to do, still, you can't lock or kickstart the plan, or the mind decides to do something else. Okay. So what is to be done? So this is a question. I think it's not the principal's question. It is 2,500 students' question.
Absolutely.
So, Anna, I just want you to take this. Even if it takes 2-3 minutes, it's okay. We have overshot. We'll, this needs to be addressed.
Let me respond with in 2-3 ways. One is mind plans, but I end up doing that or doing something else, because that's what is the point. Instead of having decided to do, still can't kickstart the plan, or mind decides not to do. Okay, so about not doing or not even starting. Let me respond it in one or two ways. One is that, how strongly do we believe? See, time management cannot come without goal management. One part of it. In that part itself is, how much do I believe in that goal? My father wants me to do. Do I want to do? My mother wants me to do. Do I want to do? The world wants me to do. Do I want to do? If you don't take a paper and pen and write down for what are you aspiring for in few lines for you to reflect every day, it will not drive you to do anything. Why are we even spending time with social media in terms of any of it? Because the pleasure of now is far exciting. We are not connecting with the pain that will come to us later on by doing this. That's one part of the question. The second part of the question also is that I didn't want to bring this up because it will be too many topics to be discussed. Nevertheless, share with it just another thought on that. There are something called peak energy, peak times and off-peak times with us in a day. A lot of research has gone into it. What is a peak time? 24 hours, you should know that. What is your peak time? Maybe your peak time is from 6 to 9, 6 to 10. Or your peak time is between the afternoon, the evening. I don't know what is your peak time. But definitely it should not be between 10 and 6 in the night. 10 in the night to 6 in the morning, you cannot say, or probably 4 o'clock, 10 to 4, you cannot say, I have a peak time. I am biased on that because that's a sleeping time. From 4 o'clock onwards, you'll be surprised that many of the professionals in the world get up as early as 3 o'clock, 3:30, 4 o'clock in the morning and start their day. Because that's their day to practice what they want to focus on. They do it. Oh, if I get up at 8 o'clock, is it bad? No, I'm not saying that. I'm not saying that only if you get up at 5 in the morning, it is good. If you get up at 8 in the morning, it's bad. No, I'm not advocating that. I'm just saying that if I want something to do, I should have a discipline to do it. I should have a goal. The path is through discipline. The inculcation of discipline is through time structuring and time management. So go back and reflect in terms of, do I believe in that goal? Am I using my peak time to spend? Which is my peak time? Oh, I don't know what is my peak time. You'll be surprised that there are times in a day where you enjoy doing certain work. That's somewhere closer to your peak time. You'll realize that. Yeah. Thank you very much. Reflect on it. I hope this answers the question. Thank you.
I mean, that was a very interesting session. I mean, it's like for me, a brush up of the 2000 Max Life training. So, I know you did something similar there. I had an initial glitch with the system, so I had to get out and come in. I'll go and watch this on YouTube again. So again, I appeal to all the students. 30 odd people are still present here and about 15% on YouTube. Your friends, when you call them and ask them to join these sessions, may feel, why are these girls pushing you? Okay. I don't know. I mean, this is one more test of you show your communication skills and get them into the live sessions, either on YouTube or on Zoom. This Zoom trial will do for another 2 or 3 sessions because I somehow like the whole concept where you can post the questions and the presenter also, Mr. Raghu, also can see those questions, and that makes more the chat more interesting, because maybe when I read the questions, I'm eating into some of the portion, or maybe I don't get the vibe of the question. So when the presenter reads it himself, it makes a lot of sense. So we'll just try. I'm not promising. YouTube anyway is there. This link of this presentation is live on YouTube. It'll be available for you to share it with your friends. And if you people have faced some technical glitch, you also can go and have a look at it. I would urge you to go and have a look at it. Simple reason, the concept looks very simple, but it's deep. And this one thing could change a lot of things for you, because suddenly you will realize when you start following these 6 steps and try to plot your thing either on a pie chart or a, you will realize that you have 2 hours, 3 hours extra per day. I mean, from where did I get this 2 hours? So your day becomes like a 26 or a 27 hour. So go watch it, read your notes again. And as Raghu suggested, maybe teach it to your brothers and sisters and maybe your parents or your uncles and aunts or cousins. That'll help you to brush up your own knowledge. So maybe they will ask you a question. So then you come back and listen to this video.
Absolutely.
And you get some clarity. So just take one step at a time. Eagerly wait for next session from Mr. Raghu.
And next session would be on goal setting. So since it's linked to it.
Great. First he's taught you how to manage your time. Now he's going to teach you on how to set goals. So let's eagerly wait for it. And I urge you to appeal to your friends to come and join. Thank you very much. We will end the session here.
Thank you for your time.
Thank you very much, Na. It was very, very interesting. And I'll disconnect the live feed. Okay, one second.